Someone is luring a strike force into the Persian Gulf.
The president is sending you to stop a war before it starts. Not
butter a crumpet.
Welcome to London, Ambassador Wilder.
Tell me how.
I'm the ambassador's wife.
My husband was an ambassador for a long time. This will be an adjustment.
You need to lean into the Cinderella thing.
I'm not doing this the way you would.
That's fine, just don't do it wrong. Not great.
Start the show.
Welcome to Cordkillers, the show about watching the stuff you love when you want, where you want, however you want. I'm Tom Merritt, and I've never started this show with my legs crossed until now.
Put a pin in that. Save it for after talk. The important thing is, Bryce, I instantly fell in love with the show. It's very rare, and hopefully it'll be more common for us to see a comedic foil of somebody having a hard time being somebody that's not a white male. So having a woman who's in over her head, that's what I loved about Parks and Recreation. Tell me about this show.
Yeah, so that was a trailer for Netflix's upcoming series, The Diplomat, where a career diplomat is sent to the UK to stop an international incident before it becomes a war. And she doesn't exactly think she's the right person for the job, and her husband used to be an ambassador. So there's a little bit of the scheming and dealing there. That's coming to Netflix on April 20th. It's a series.
Wait, so her husband in the show is still alive and they're happily married. He just like, I used to have, basically he's Bill Clinton. He's like, I used to have your job.
Right. Seems like it.
Okay.
Seems all right.
Except he's played by a guy that used to be a Nazi in the United States in the Philip K. Dick Man in the High Castle.
Oh, got it. Okay.
Wow.
Yeah. And then she's Felicity.
Oh.
Okay.
Okay. And then, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. This makes sense.
For those listening to audio, he was sniffing her armpits. You couldn't see that on the audio.
You could get
which,
the sniff, though.
For the record, is a fairly, like, very real, long-time married couple thing to do.
Hey, like, am I good? Sniff me. Yeah, hey, sniff me.
Oh, no, you're not good. Oh, no, you're okay. Yeah. Folks, let's get to the primary target. It's Star Wars. Probably one of the reasons that she was being sent to London was Star Wars Celebration, which happened in London this weekend. Brian has been kept in the dark. He has sequestered himself from Star Wars news so that he can give you a fresh, unspoiled take on each one of these elements. Brian, are you ready for me to run through the Star Wars Celebration news?
I will, except for I must disclose that I did see the clip of Christian Haydenson, Hayden Christensen.
Hayden Christensen,
Darth Vader. Clearly, like, being very emotional at the response he got. That was really, really precious. I enjoyed that very much. That's okay, the good. Only thing we'll, I know.
We covered that within. That one's good. We'll take that one off the board. Let's start with the new movie strategy. The next film will be directed by Sharmeen Obaid-Chinoy of the Marvels TV show fame. Daisy Ridley is going to be in it, playing Rey in the last in the 15 years following the events of Rise of Skywalker. So she's building a new order. The Jedi have been in disarray after Rise of Skywalker. It will be written by Stephen Knight, who worked on Peaky Blinders. Two other movies. Well, actually, let me get to the Taika Waititi movie still in development. Deadpool's Sean Levy still attached to direct a film. But the big news was, of course, the Rey movie. And then Kathleen Kennedy announced two other movies. James Mangold will direct a film set at the dawn of the Jedi. So, you know, early, old stuff. And Dave Filoni is helming a New Republic film that will close out the Mandalorian Boba Fett Ahsoka TV series in a film. So you've got the Rey, the new 15 years after the Skywalker saga Rey movie. You got James Mangold doing a Dawn of the Jedi movie, and Filoni tying up all the TV shows with a New Republic movie.
I know which one I'm most excited about it as a fan, but Tom, I would love to hear which one. I assume the Ahsoka one will be the one you're most excited about.
I actually think I'm most excited about Dawn of the Jedi.
The James Mangold one.
the Mangold. I like Mangold stuff, of course. Right. Okay, but just give me that time period. Give me something that's like way in the past. I love that sort of like origin story, deep in the past, mysticism. How did it all come about? I'm less interested in tying up the TV shows that I didn't think needed to be tied up, but maybe I'll change my mind as they converge. And I don't know, man. I thought we were done with the Skywalker saga. So I'm excited to see more Daisy Ridley. I am skeptical about what those stories will be.
That's really well put. And I think I agree with everything you just said. The Ahsoka stuff, from what you've told me, like if you watch the cartoons, there's a lot of backstory there. And I'm sure that'll be very satisfying. Dave Filoni, obviously involved with
Mandalorian.
And
it's got Mandalorian in it too. Right, so exactly. Mandalorian in a movie could be fun. Yeah.
That one, I'm sort of like, it's been up, it's been down. I don't know where to put it in my head. However, James Mangold doing a Before Everything story really, really tickles my fancy. There are two things I loved very, very much. Knights of the Old Republic, the Xbox One or original Xbox game was awesome because it was so far in the past that none, like it had all of the lore and the lightsabers and so on, but no restrictions, and it was great. So if they're doing something kind of close to that, that would be rad. James Mangold is a made man in my heart and forever for Logan. Logan is the best comic book movie of all time. Full stop.
Yeah, and I'm excited for all three of these in various ways. I mean, the idea of a movie wrapping up is something I said I don't need, but doesn't mean I won't be interested to see what Filoni does, because Filoni does good stuff. I like the way Filoni tells stories. So I'm in for all of these.
Which brings us to the question of the wild card of Rey. Daisy Ridley is a fantastic actor. Like, I really dug her as a character and as a person and all that. It was a bit of a whiplash bummer that it appeared to be the three movies she was in were like two directors arguing with each other. I very much look forward to the possibility of a thing that all of us can agree is awesome and new and different and whatever.
Yeah, that could be good. And I like who they have in charge of it. I guess that's what I'm hung up on is I don't need more Skywalker saga. Honestly, if they hadn't decided Rey was going to call herself Skywalker, I'd be fine with it. I'd be like, yes, Rey is the new beginning. Rey is the separation. Rey is taking us away from all of that. That's over. Rey is the new. Let's see what she does. And I think that's what they're trying to do here. I'm just hung up on that one little bit of her saying, like, you can call me Skywalker because don't want to. There's a teaser trailer for Ahsoka, which is coming to Disney Plus in August. There are lots of cameos from Star Wars Rebels characters. The words "heir to the Empire," if you're a fan of that. Those words are uttered. And Brian, Lars Mikkelsen has been cast as Grand Admiral Thrawn.
Okay, Tom, how much do I get to explain? How much time do I get to explain to everybody how special this is?
And go.
Okay, so Grand Admiral Thrawn is somebody who is the great thing about the Heir to the Empire series is that Grand Admiral Thrawn is somebody who does not have the Force. There's no mysticism. He is simply full on Vulcan Spock-like, but he understands the value of art, and he believes that art is the thing that speaks a species, a culture's values, and he uses that as a military tactic in order to defeat his enemies. Seeing the Empire positioned as you almost want to root for them because they stand for civility and order and all those things. And to see somebody who is not using Jedi mysticism and it says, no, I just think about things from other people's perspectives. It is an amazing series. And if there is any possibility that a mere whisper of this is going to make it onto the big screen, the small screen, I don't care. I'm 100% all in.
Yeah. So Ahsoka has piqued Brian's interest when it comes to Disney Plus in August. Trailer for season 2 of Star Wars Visions. If you're like, which one is that again? It's the anthology series where each independent story, they don't feed off each other, is animated by a different studio. lots of very great studios in this coming season, including Aardman of Wallace and Gromit fame. Season two, Star Wars Visions coming May 4th.
Do they invent a new way to make a lightsaber with an awesome five-headed dogs or something?
It's definitely got that feel. It's got a little comic feel to it, but there's a serious story in there too that you can sort of glean from the trailer. And there's some photorealistic animation. There's some very anime, classic anime animation. So that's a trailer worth checking out. That is, again, Star Wars Visions coming May the 4th, right there on May the 4th Be With You Day. The Acolyte will arrive on Disney Plus in 2024. It is set during a time period between the High Republic and the Phantom Menace. So again, in a slightly unexplored area of the storyline.
Yeah.
TV show.
Yep. Yep.
Yep, that's the Acolyte. More details for Star Wars Skeleton Crew. This is the one starring Jude Law, run by Jon Favreau. Directors for episodes were announced, including John Watts, The Daniels, David Lowery, Jake Schreier, Bryce Dallas Howard, and Lee Isaac Chung.
These are the kind of things where it's like, I don't know how to gauge enthusiasm because I just don't know enough. Great, new things.
Dave Filoni confirmed that there will be a second season of Tales of the Jedi. These are like independent mini stories. So the first season told the story about Ahsoka Tano and one about Count Dooku. Those were three episode arcs. So they didn't tell us what we're going to get. At least I didn't see it, but there will be another season of that.
I will say that as somebody who is very, very hungry in the 1990s for like more just anything Star Wars, the Tales From collections of short stories, Tales mm-hmm. from the Cantina, Tales of the Bounty Hunters, Tales of Jabba's Palace or whatever, those were the best. You got all these sci-fi pros who made up awesome backstories for somebody you saw 3 seconds in the series. Fingers crossed.
Return of the Jedi is coming back to theaters April 28th in celebration of the 40th anniversary of its release on May 25th, 1983.
Tom?
Yes, Brian?
Is this going to be, what's the word, embarrassing?
Did you go see Star Wars or Empire Strikes Back in the theater when they re-released them?
I did, but I was
You did?
Nine.
I said when they re-released them recently.
Well,
when they re-released them.
Oh, like in the last 10 years? I went for the special editions. They did re-releases
around the anniversaries of those as well.
No, and I did not.
Yeah, well, then there's no need
to do this in the theater. Also, is this going to be the special edition, or are they going to have a bunch of like a weird 30-year-old CGI only one in
edition.
There?
There's only one edition that Disney has to release.
I hate it already, Tom. I just realized that could be literally the title of every episode of the show.
Only a couple more things. Star Wars The Bad Batch is getting a third and final season. So if you ever did decide that you wanted to catch up on The Bad Batch, you will have a full and complete story after the next season, whenever that finally hits sometime next year.
I didn't.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But, I mean, you could. In the future is all. You could.
I won't.
And I have good news for you, Brian.
Yes.
Andor season 2 is in production.
The only thing I've heard about Andor season 2 that makes me sad is that they don't intend to figure out like some kind of time travel that allows Andor to get to season 9. like it sounds like they're going to do an anthology and it's just going to be little bits skipping that bring us to what was the movie I didn't like?
Star Wars.
Rogue One.
Rogue One, yeah.
Gambling Man in our chat room says the Acolyte is described by the showrunner as Frozen meets Kill Bill.
Yeah, that makes sense.
All right. I'm in.
Yeah, it's Citizen Kane meets like, you know, Donnie Darko. It's just kind of like, could pick two more opposite things.
It's Wallace and Gromit meets the Gladiator.
Well, one of the interesting questions that brings up is like, how gritty does Disney get away with announcing a thing's going to be, considering the fact that the whole reason everybody loved Star Wars is that it was sci-fi, but super gritty. Like, you know, you had somebody murdering somebody under the table and chopping off arms and all that stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like, then they sanitized all of that. And then it's like, but now it's gritty. And now I just want to cross my arms and be all like,
Yeah. I do think that the big news is that they're bringing Daisy Ridley back, and I'm very curious who else is going to be in that movie and who, what that story is going to be. I mean, they gave us little bits of the story, like I said, but, you know, John Boyega has been on the record saying he doesn't feel any need to ever go back, to Star Wars. So I wouldn't expect we'd see Finn, but that seems a little disappointing. On the other hand, if they are really separating from the Skywalker saga, then yeah, maybe that's right. Maybe we see Rey and no one else we know in this. That could be interesting.
Yeah.
Listen, Brian is powered by your support on Patreon.
Oh my God. Look, we talked about this. It's a medical condition, Tom. And, and it's this is a HIPAA violation that you just made by outing me. Yes, it's true. I have blood cells that are very peculiarly aligned, such that the only thing that keeps them running through my veins, the only thing that allows me to be a father to my three daughters and a husband to my wife, is money. Okay, fine. Now it's out. And not just any money. You can't just give me money. Mm-mm. It's only money from patreon.com/cordkillers.
Yeah, it's I'm glad that I'm hip for announcing this. I appreciate you saying so. And I think that people should understand that if you are not backing us at patreon.com/cordkillers with actual money, I don't think it's overstating it to say you're killing Brian.
Well, I mean, it's true insofar as I will literally die if
someday
if anybody stops their subscription, or if somebody's like on the fence and doesn't give us money to keep this show going. Like,
this is why we get messages when people are freaking out about their pledges disappearing.
by the way, weird side jag. Like, there is a legitimate frustration for a lot of people who, like, in the very early days, pledged one penny per episode as a joke, and now they really want to up their pledge, but for some, whatever reason, there's some bug where they can't do it. So to you guys, I say, find a friend and explain that your friend Brian is about to die.
Hey, I'm gonna need to pull out that credit card. My friend needs us
over at patreon.com/cordkillers.
Let's talk about how to watch. Deadline says a report from the agency UTA found that 2/3 of Americans say the length of time between a movie's release in theaters and its availability at home has little or no impact on the decision to see the movie in the theater or not. When asked to name the most recent streaming original movie they watched, only 1/4 of consumers correctly listed one. I guess some of them said things that weren't streaming movies. I don't know. Only 8 of the 24 titles survey respondents said they had most recently seen were original films made for streaming platforms, implying that 16 of them were theater-based movies. Of people who haven't returned to the theater since the pandemic, 28% say it's because they have something at home that they can watch. 47% said it's the price, too pricey to go to the movies, and 38% were concerned about health and safety. UTA CEO Jeremy Zimmer said in a press release, "The study proves that we intuitively believed that there is nothing wrong with the movie business that better films and cleaner theaters can't fix."
Man, I am so glad somebody finally said it, because I conducted my own independent survey. I asked my Weimaraner, Joy, a very large dog who is very smart. I said, "Would you rather have this Cocoa Puff right now, or $1 billion worth of all the dog food you want in 5 minutes?" And she correctly said, "I want this Cocoa Puff right now." And from which I took, I'm apparently doing everything just great. My point being, why are you asking the consumers any of these questions, and why are you taking any of their answers at face value? It's your job as the creator to understand that withholding information is a favor that you're doing for the people who are going to consume your art.
I that's funny, and it's probably true. However, I do think that everyone overestimates how important the window is. And I do think that things like price, which if you notice, Jeremy Zimmer says better movies, not lower prices. In other words, saying, well, we just got to make the movies worth the price. But I think there are more things like that that affect theater attendance than we give credit for. It's not to say the window doesn't have any effect at all. You're absolutely right, Brian. But I know a lot of times I don't sit here and think, well, I'll have to wait 87 days to see this movie, but I guess I can wait, or no, I should probably go to the theater. No, I think first, do I want to drive to the theater? Oh, wait, the one near me closed. Do I want to drive to that other theater? It's kind of a pain to get in and out of, and I don't love it. I think, oh, it's going to take me this long to get there, and then I have to watch the movie, which is 3 hours, and then it's going to take me this long to get home. Maybe I don't want to commit that time. Those are the things that go through my mind. And I usually end up watching a movie at home that was in theaters, not because I made a logical decision to wait, but because I kept procrastinating going to the theater long enough that it came out at home. And I'm like, well, I do want to see it. I better watch it at home. So again, I'm just one data point. I'm not saying I'm representative, but I think there's something to these responses where people say, yeah, it's not, the biggest thing isn't whether it's going to be delayed or not on streaming. The biggest thing is, do I want to see the movie, and will I pay the price in time and money to see it?
Let me give you first the version that I really hate to admit out loud, and then a possibility of redemption. The thing I hate to say out loud is, this is the part where we get to, maybe there's a reason that of a $100 million movie budget, only $15 million goes to creating the movie and the rest is marketing. Like, there's clearly something to the fact that everybody wants to be hyped at the same time about the same thing, and it's only marketing that's going to pay for all of those awesome trailers and the bonus features and the integrations and the popcorn special buckets that open and all of that stuff. I think that is absolutely true, and I don't like it. If there's a way out, the only way out that I know of is, at this point, I just look at, and Tom, please disclose if you have any conflicts of interest here. I look at Rotten Tomatoes, and if it's over 90, then I know that I'm gonna go to my local theater. I'm gonna get a pizza and an adult beverage, and I'm gonna be able to bring my kids, and everything will be quiet and nice, and I'll have a pleasant time for 2 whole hours. Do you think we're gonna lean more towards that, or do you think we're gonna lean back to, No. We're going to spend 80% of our budget on priming everybody to be excited for a thing before it comes out.
Yeah, no, that's a really good question. And yes, my wife works for Rotten Tomatoes.
I didn't know that.
I know. I should have told you a long time ago. I apologize. I think there is something there to say, maybe you should just be marketing the theater. What if the studios got in with Landmark and, I don't know, freaking Movie Pass and everybody, and said, let's make some it's great to go to the theater promotions. And yeah, we can throw in a little trailer elements there because that's good. People like that. But I don't know, if you make it easier and more fun to go to the theater, I'm going to go more often, because what you're describing, Brian, is I go to the theater because it's fun. Because it's simple for me to go, and I get a positive benefit out of it. And you didn't talk about, but I only go when it's a movie I want to watch, right? I think the movie selection is important. I'm not trying to say it's not important at all, but I think we sometimes forget that there are other elements that are all a drag on this process, even when there's a movie people do want to see.
Well, and I think you touched on something that I would very much like to see. For example, on late night television, I never knew what movie was going to come after Elvira introduced it or Joe Bob Briggs introduced it. But I did know that Joe Bob Briggs would explain to me what I should get out of it, and I would have a good time. And then he would come back before the commercial break and explain, you know, and set up a couple of jokes or whatever. I would love to have a theater right around the corner where there's somebody who I just want to have them MC. And like, for example, our friend, C. Robert Cargill, like imagine Cargill had his own theater. I would buy blind, you know, seven tickets. I'd invite a bunch of friends. I'd be like, what are we watching? I'm like, no idea, but Cargill's going to explain why it's great. And we're going to have a great time. I would love to see more of that happen.
And when I have been in a situation where I lived near an easy to go to theater, when I lived in a situation where the theater was brand new and had fun new things that I'd never experienced before, like, you know, bringing me drinks to my seat, like the Alamo did, then I started to see more movies. I started to find excuses to go see movies. When MoviePass came out and it was like unlimited movies, and it was like, oh man, I could just go on the whenever I have time and just see whatever's there. I know that Bryce and other people saw more movies. So that to me is the lesson of this. Whether this survey is accurately made or made in good faith, those are the thoughts that it provoked in me anyway.
I feel like both you and I, Tom, already have kind of default positions on this question. I would love to hear, Bryce, do you mind chiming in?
Yeah, price is a big factor for me.
Comes with Bryce.
Theater tickets get expensive. If you're doing food, if it's becoming a meal, if there's drinks, if there are other people around, it becomes a pretty expensive night out. If you want like the nice experience, and then if you want the cheaper one, those theaters are not great. You know, there are a lot of bad screens, a lot of bad sound systems out there. Every time I go to my cheap movie theater, I can see a glare from the projector on the screen.
I definitely know which of the 16 screens at the local movie theater, if they say this theater, I'm like, there's a broken pixel up in the upper left-hand corner. This one's in the lower right, you know, whatever.
And so, like, I do understand where the theater owners are coming from, which is often like, we're a good value for the money. We can be a good value we can entertain you for two and a half hours for a pretty good price compared to some other things.
Yeah, right.
But I think they really need to get their game together. They either need to clean up these theaters or they need to figure out a way to bring prices correctly, because they are competing with streaming, whether or not they know it.
Yeah. No, it's interesting because movie theater pricing suffers from gas price perception, right? Where we're talking about $4 or $5 a gallon, but people act like a couple cents difference is huge in the marketplace. So like the way they talk about it. When you just pointed out, Bryce, that yeah, compared to baseball or concerts or, you know, other things you can do with your time that last around the same time, movies are a screaming bargain as far as what you pay for them. And even the price of food that goes there is cheaper in a movie theater, albeit inflated, compared to the inflated prices at concerts and sports. So on the one hand, it is hugely a bargain. On the other hand, that's not how people think about it. They think about it as, well, how much would I pay to go do that versus watch it at home, even though it's not the same thing. That's just not how people think about it. So you gotta address that.
Yeah. And I always kind of get the feeling when I go into a movie theater, like, oh, you're paying for all of these extra seats. Like we made the 13 theaters and we couldn't sell all these tickets, but we got to jack up the prices. So it's almost a chicken and egg sort of thing of like, well, if you had more people, I would feel like, okay, maybe the price is more reasonable. But a lot of times I go to the theaters and they're half empty.
Yeah. All right. Let's talk about what to watch in Under Surveillance. James Gunn is no dummy. James Gunn knows how to sing sweet music to fans. James Gunn told Empire Magazine that a Marvel DC movie crossover is, quote, more likely now that I'm in charge of DC. Who knows? However, he also said, that's many years away, though. I think we have to establish what we're doing at DC first. I would be lying to say that we haven't discussed it, but all discussions have been very, very light and fun.
So in this case, speaking as a comic book fan since, you know, second grade or whatever, in the beginning there was DC, then there was Marvel, which was DC characters with a interesting flaw. Then Marvel did very well, and then they did the cash grab or best story ever of Secret Wars, where they're like, what if all of our characters all fought at once over, I don't know, power? Great, let's go. And then they did it. And then 10 years after that, in the 90s, there was, by a mutually agreed upon accord, this bizarre, I never read any of those, but basically it was like they paired up a bunch of DC people against Marvel people, and they all did battle for reasons. So given the fact that we saw in the MCU starting 2005 with Iron Man, we saw kind of canonical Marvel grow, then we saw the Avengers, then we saw all the crossover, and now we're up to coming up on 30 movies or whatever. Mm-hmm. Now we're headed into what appears to be Secret Invasion, followed by Secret Wars and all that stuff. Great. It does make sense that the movies would continue to follow the pattern of what was established beforehand. That'll be interesting. And all I could say.
James Gunn's not wrong. He is uniquely positioned to make this happen, running DC Studios and being a former, you know, Marvel director and knowing all those people over there. I'm sure when he says they've had discussions that are light and fun, you know how that goes. You're at a conference, you're at a Guardians of the Galaxy launch event, for goodness sake, after you've already taken over DC, and you're chatting with Kevin Feige and other people, and you're like, man, wouldn't it be great? I know there's a lot to have. Wouldn't it be great? Can you imagine what we do? That kind of stuff. And like, oh man, that would be so fun. I hope we can figure that out someday. Yeah, that all scans. That topic would have to come up just for all the reasons that Brian gave.
Well, and also I think that's careful and correct language that he used when he said it's more likely now that I'm in charge of DC than it was beforehand. That is factually 100% true.
Yeah, 100%. And I'm sure they've talked about it. None of this means it's ever going to happen, but it certainly is interesting to think about. Warner Brothers Discovery is close to a deal to produce a Harry Potter TV series. Bloomberg says the series would be directly based on the books. J.K. Rowling would have creative involvement, but not serve as primary creator or showrunner, which she has served as primary creative director on plays and even movies before. So this would be, I guess, a reboot in TV form of the same thing they made the movies about.
How much of that carefully crafted sentence do you think is a nod to the current peculiar moment J.K. Rowling is having in the social media?
Oh, all of it. Yeah. Also, I carefully crafted this particular sentence out of other carefully crafted sentences. Right. So don't try to parse it too closely, because it's my paraphrasing of what other people have said. But yeah, absolutely. They're trying to steer against that, no doubt.
Yeah.
What do you think of redoing the story with a new cast as a TV show?
I think that's going to be very profitable. And to be quite honest, I read Harry Potter around the same time that I was reading Game of Thrones. And once you've gone full Game of Thrones, it's very hard to have the patience for the preschool level fantasy that is Harry Potter.
You're a wizard, Sam. Disney showed off a trailer for Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny at Star Wars Celebration, because you know what? The people at Star Wars Celebration wanted to see this. It is coming June 30th. They are planning to premiere it at the Cannes Film Festival in May, though, so we may get some early temperature checks of how people like it. I have to say, Brian, it is a trailer worth watching, because it restored my faith that this is not going to be Crystal Skull, that it is going to be more like the first three movies, and that the de-aging, at least in the trailer, looked fairly decent and well-motivated.
I mean, to be honest, deepfake technology, this has been an extraordinary year for AI, for deepfakes, for you name it. If this is mostly a flex on the technology that makes it possible to bring back to life the characters that we remember from when we were in kindergarten or whatever, then great. I've heard nothing but good things about this.
Yeah. And it does look like those are just like flashback telling the story of how we got you know, to this point, because the Dial of Destiny is a thing that he got back in the day, and now everyone's looking for it again, right? So I like that. That seems pretty elegant. New trailer for Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse is out, coming to theaters June 2nd. We now check in with Brian's excitement for Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse.
100%. In fact, I saw the Dungeons & Dragons movie so many times that I am certain that I saw this trailer in the theater. I just don't know which, like, I saw three different versions of a Spider-Verse trailer. I love everything about the universe. I love everything about the pacing. I love everything about the characters. It's great. Lord and Miller can do no wrong. And my axe, I say.
Finally, Be Real, B-R-E-E-L Films, makers of Midsommar, if you know that film, will begin production this autumn on a TV series to tell the story of the Pirate Bay.
Oh.
Yes, that is right. The personalities, the perils, the peccadillos of the people who ran the Pirate Bay come into Sweden's SVT public broadcaster as a six-part drama. Now, worldwide, Dynamic Television has the distribution rights, so they're going to MIP TV in Cannes April 17th. If you would like to get it on your platform, find them. I'm sure they're willing to make a deal.
This is a good story. This is like a I've heard also things I've heard good things about is the Tetris movie on Apple TV Plus. This seems like a Tetris level story. It is a global story, but also about individual humans. We've talked about this before. I love big story, small story at the same time. Seems like it's going to have all of the ingredients. I think one of the Pirate Bay guys like got into politics at some point.
Yeah, there was the Pirate Party.
Great story that I cannot wait to see told multiple times.
Will you pay to see it?
Yes. Yes. I always would, except for, you know what? Never mind. there might have been a time that I wouldn't have paid for
it. It was the obvious comment on a Pirate Bay movie to ask if you pay to see it.
I'll tell you this much, Tom. This show and all of the iterations that came before it are the reasons that I gave up piracy, full stop. I realized I could not appear on screen and also not, I used to be an unrepentant pirate, Tom. I was so bad. I was so, so bad. But not since we started doing any of these shows.
Yeah. This is like confession for piracy.
Yep.
This show right here, folks. Come on
confession
in.
Confession ASMR. Yeah.
Now, I do have one last question on this before we move on. What do you think, which platform would you prefer get this? Is it HBO? Is it Apple TV? Is it Netflix? Is it Amazon? Where do you think the best fit for the Pirate Bay 6-part series is?
If I were picking based on irony alone, it would be HBO, because HBO, as you and I remember, enjoyed an extended stretch where they loudly touted the fact that they were the most pirated content in the world, but it was because they refused to make any legal way to acquire Game of Thrones, right? But if I'm doing it based on, I'd like to see this land with Apple TV Plus.
I was gonna say the same thing.
Yeah.
It just feels like it should, partly because what you said about Tetris, partly because it's a tech company. I don't know.
Well, especially also like part of the legacy of Apple is, remember at the height of piracy, it was Steve Jobs who took to the stage and announced to everybody, shut up. It's going to be 99 cents a track. That's it.
Piracy over.
Yes.
Yeah.
$10 an album, 99 cents a track. All y'all quit crying.
That's how it works.
He was right.
Yeah. He also raised a pirate flag over Apple's campus in the 80s, right? Because he was taking on the big...
I believe that too. Yeah. No, everything aligns on Apple TV Plus.
By the way, my legs are still crossed. All right. What did we have our eyes on? This is something I'm excited to mention this one. Brian, have you heard about Beef on Netflix?
I think I did, but I don't remember what it is.
You know the comedian Ali Wong?
No.
Okay. Do you know Steve Yeun from Walking Dead?
Yes.
Yeah. Glenn. Those are the two main characters. They play the two main characters. It starts with a road rage incident in a parking lot between those two, and then spirals into them one-upping each other while interweaving the personal stories that are causing them all the stress. Ali Wong's character, Amy, is trying to sell her small business to this big corporate overlord and cash out and make all the money.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And he is a struggling contractor trying to make a go of it, putting together handyman business. So there's this interweave story of them like looking each other up and finding where they live and threatening each other because they're so angry about the road rage incident, but also what's feeding all of this anxiety that causes it. It's from A24. It's from the same guy who did Dave, the Hulu series. It's great. It's really, really good.
I only watched the first episode, but it's interesting. They do a good job of giving
really interesting.
Both of those characters meaty roles. I always think that's a tough thing in a duo series like this, is giving both characters equal time.
And I do love the conceit of like every single road rage incident when you're 1,000 feet away and you're not either of the two people. They're all dumb as hell. Yeah, and to give a context of where everybody's at in that very dumb moment that everybody is eventually going to agree was a very dumb moment. I love that.
And the idea that you just can't let it go sometimes, even though it's ridiculous. And even though you start to realize it's ridiculous, and that every argument is really about something else. It's a really well-told story. It's that kind of story where you're like, well, the obvious thing to do here would be this, and they don't do that. Or they go, yeah, the obvious thing for us to do is this. It's like they just paint a big red target on it. And you're like, oh, they're acknowledging that. That's interesting. So anyway, that's Beef. It is available on Netflix. Brian, you got anything you've had your eyes on?
Oh my gosh, dude. I've been watching so much video, specifically one video. The trailer for World's Greatest Con, available now on iTunes or wherever you get your podcast, created by Bill Meeks and Justin Robert Young, featuring the voice of yours truly. So it's the best trailer. I mean, I suppose you could also go to iTunes and subscribe to the podcast or follow it, as they say nowadays. Anyway, World's Greatest Con, it's been all I've been able to see for a long time.
Yeah, go watch it with your ears. Bryce, what have you been on the lookout for?
Hey, I got a blast from the present. This is a recent animated film. It's called Aqua Teen Forever Plantasm. This came out last year as a VOD purchase or rental, but now it's streaming on HBO Max. Boy, howdy. They hadn't missed a minute. They hadn't missed a beat with Aqua Teen Hunger Force. If you saw the Aqua Teen Hunger Force : movie film for theaters, 10, 15 years ago?
I think even longer than that. it was a minute.
It's pretty much more of that. But even better, I think the interesting thing about Aqua Teen Hunger Force has always been that the animation has been very cheap. And now it's HBO. They got access to animation. So just animate it like a regular cartoon. You still got Frylock and Jake and all that stuff there. It's great. The other great thing about it, Aqua Teen Hunger Force, great because it's short. This film is 75 minutes long.
Woo!
It is not around to mess around. It's very funny. They got everybody back. They even do a bunch of meta jokes about it because it was out on premium VOD. So there's a bunch of like, you paid for this and all this stuff. They screw with you. But it's really fun. It's on HBO Max now. And I gotta say, like, I kind of hope they keep making more of these.
I hope so too. I'm not.
It's better
yet
than trying
it
to keep make the show. Honestly.
Well, I remember scrolling through the Rotten Tomatoes reviews, and one of my favorites was actually, it's kind of a good movie.
Like, they've still got Matt and Dave who write it and put it together, so it really feels exactly like the Aqua Teen that you know and love. So that's called Aqua Teen Forever Plantasm. It's on HBO Max now. And
question, Bryce. Yeah. Mm-hmm. My daughter ain't seen none of these. She's 15, mm-hmm. prime demographic for this kind mm-hmm. of stuff. Mm-hmm. Would she appreciate being just launched on this?
Yeah, probably. It's not that complicated. Okay. Like the only kind of complicated thing is that they start off separate. The Aqua Teens are separated, and then they have to come together.
Kind
of come together. Yeah. But it's great. There's a great bit about the Llama Dolly.
Oh yes, I remember that.
The Llama Dolly, not the Dalai Lama, and some interesting Amazon Blue Origin Elon-y sort of figure. So check it out. If you've got something we should be on the lookout for, please email it to us. Our email address is cordkillers@gmail.com. Thank you.
The best way to do an email, Brian, is to get a doghouse system.
Yes. Everybody knows. Look, I hate to be the one to break it to you, but most probably every email you've been writing has been corrupted by big, bad computers. Big bad computers, they corrupt your emails. That's the doghouse guarantee, is they're not affected by big bad computers. If you go to doghousesystems.com/rogue, use promo code rogue at checkout, you get yourself a high-end premium system, you'll get unparalleled customer service, and no big bad computers messing with your emails.
You know what the first thing I would do if I got a brand new amazing doghouse system?
Right, I mean, I would hope it would be to sign up for an email subscription somewhere, because you know it would be uncorrupted.
Not today, Satan. No, today I would launch a browser. I would type in the words "world's greatest con." I would search those in the search engine. I would click on it. I would subscribe or follow or whatever the F they want, because this is literally the best podcast I've listened to in the past 365 days.
It's
probably
not,
longer.
It's not bad, right? Like, I mean,
it's really good.
No BS.
The way I tell people about World's Greatest Con is, this is a fascinating story. You're going to want to hear the story told the way they're telling it, knowing what you know about it. Then you're going to find out things that no one knew about this story until they started working on telling it. And what happened to me was, Brian sent me an early copy and I said, I'll listen to most of episode one so I could at least tell him I listened to it, give him some feedback. And I finished the whole thing that night. You can't do that, but you can get the very first two episodes and get in on the ground floor. So go over there and search for World's Greatest Con in your favorite search engine or your podcast player of choice. Do it now for yourself, not because I'm asking you or because it helps Brian, although it does, but also because you're going to enjoy it. There's just no two ways about it. So go do that right now.
If I can put a little pin, I'm going to talk out of school real quick. Teller of Penn and Teller really, really likes this. And that kind of broke Justin Robert Young's brain, because he told me today, he said, well, whenever I try to engage in my self-loathing complex, I realize that I'm arguing against Teller and I can't do that. So I have to just give up and admit it's pretty good. We made a good thing.
You did it. All right, let's move on to the front lines.
Front lines!
Super Mario Brothers set several records at the box office. It's the highest opening for an animated movie worldwide at $377 million. For the five-day opening record, which not every movie qualifies because a lot of them do three-day openings, but the Wednesday through Sunday record, it passed Transformers Revenge of the Fallen with $204.6 million. And it's the third-best Easter weekend, going back to the three-day window, third-best Easter weekend opening, right behind Furious 7 and the best Easter weekend opening ever, Batman versus Superman.
So I'm not entirely sure what the takeaway here is, Tom. Have any of the three of us seen this movie? Is it good?
I have not. I've not seen it yet. No.
I hear it's good, but the critics maybe don't love it.
The rotten critics tomatoes at it.
Okay.
The people seem to love it.
You need to disclose this metaphor, Tom.
Yeah, that metaphor.
Netflix's follow-up live broadcast will be a reunion special for Love is Blind. Love is Blind, the live reunion, will stream from LA on Sunday, April 16th at 8 p.m. Eastern.
This is a smart follow-up, right? You tested it with Chris Rock. You're like, okay, we know how to do live now. You know that people want to see a reunion special live. A little disappointing when Netflix puts out the reunion specials pre-recorded, because you're like, well, not. I don't get the feeling that anything could happen, even though they say they didn't edit it. Now they won't be. Anything could happen. And that's, you may not like reality shows, but people who do, that's what they want to see.
Well,
and live finales. Big.
Right. And on top of that, it's like, oh man, is there one thing anybody who watches a reality show wants more than something unscripted, truly off the menu happens? Yeah. Like, if they're willing to deal with it, then great.
Canceled HBO shows that were removed from HBO Max have finally begun showing up on the Roku channel, as we said they would. HBO's Westworld, The Nevers, and Raised by Wolves, along with canceled reality shows, including F-Boy Island and Legendary. There are in total 14 new Warner Brothers related channels now live on Roku channel.
Of everything you just said, which is the show you're most surprised is now on Roku?
F-Boy Island, I guess.
Bryce?
It would be Raised by Wolves. That show is not done. That show was an HBO Max. I guess a lot of these were HBO Max.
Yeah.
All HBO Max.
For me, it would be Westworld, because boy, did they bet heavy.
Oh, Westworld.
Boy, did they insist it was going to eventually get good.
I mean, I thought it got good at the end there.
My favorite version of it was the version you guys told me about, and then I had to watch all the episodes to get caught up.
It was just a bummer they didn't give a great ending to Westworld.
Yeah.
I take it back. Westworld is the most surprising that it's on that went to fast, except the way they do these deals a lot of times is they can do a fast deal and a VOD deal, a streaming video on demand deal. So this may not preclude Westworld from showing up somewhere else. They just think it's too expensive to put on HBO Max, probably because of royalty deals. I don't know. Maybe the royalty deals are better with commercials. There's a lot of questions.
That is one thing you cannot take away from Westworld, is that it looked very expensive. T-Mobile extended its partnership to offer MLB TV for free to its subscribers through 2028. MLB TV lets you watch out-of-market games. T-Mobile makes this available to subscribers for a limited time near the start of the season each year.
Yeah.
Tom, much do you, are you, hooray?
I am... five.
Are you hooray?
I am five hooray.
Wouldn't that be a great thing, like in a congressional inquiry? Sir, how much are you hooray?
This is a simple question. How much are you hooray? Yes or no?
Not Barbie a verbal trailer. Media. We don't need to get this out or anything.
The Barbie trailer took the meme world by storm. There were Barbie memes all over the place. Barbie stars every celebrity you ever loved and comes out July 21st. Aquaman and the Lost Kingdom has moved off of Christmas 5 days earlier, so the Aquaman movie is going to be coming out December 20th this year. Netflix announced that season 4, part 2 of Manifest comes out June 2nd. Netflix has also ordered an animated Stranger Things spinoff. No details on the story there. Amazon's MGM is rebranding the Epic streaming service as MGM Plus internationally. It already did that in the US. MGM also extended its deal with Lionsgate to include key European territories. Disney announced it began a live-action adaptation of Moana, which just came out as an animated film in 2016. So we're almost ready to lap the animated films. Pretty soon they'll be putting out the live action adaptation and the animated film at the same time. HBO is eyeing a Game of Thrones movie and TV series about Aegon the Conqueror, and Shrek 5 Donkey spinoff with Eddie Murphy is being discussed by DreamWorks.
I guess out of all of these, the one I'm most excited about is the Barbie phenomenon. I'm really excited. Again, I've not seen it, but I saw the precursor to it, where Barbie's been making some like super secret, really scathing, insightful, awesome, smart insights for a little bit. And so from what I understand, that's what we're looking at with the movie.
Yeah. Agreed. Also, I think I must have accidentally said Epic instead of Epics, the Epics streaming service. My apologies for the mispronunciation. Let's get to the dispatches from the front. Russ in Houston loves your enthusiasm for Secret Invasion, Fantastic Four, and such, Brian. And his hope is that it'll introduce the Fantastic Four in Secret Invasion. They finished filming Secret Invasion about a year ago and haven't even cast Fantastic Four. So I doubt they're going to make an appearance.
Okay, also, Fantastic Four is going to be a fantasy from me. That's fine.
Also, Russ also says, Brian, just in case you have any shred of joy left in your life, Fantastic Four is going to be a tentpole release. I doubt they're going to neuter that premiere in a Disney Plus show.
I don't know, man. Like Fantastic Four has a peculiar legacy of being nothing but failures. And part of me would really like to see, and we've talked about this before, Jason Murphy and I, if we could, it would be a Doom movie that eventually reveals the Fantastic Four. That would be amazing.
And then Steve asks a very interesting question. Why doesn't Netflix charge $10 extra or separate for a service that lets you watch new-to-rental movies? If I want to watch a movie now, it costs me $5.99 to rent. They could also include older movies that I now pay $4 to see, if not already streaming somewhere else. They obviously have negotiated deals with studios for their DVD business, just trying to help Netflix turn a buck.
So, Tom, I included this one because the numbers he quoted don't line up with the numbers I've experienced. In general, the moment something is available for rental, it's, you know, $1.99 standard def or $2.99 high def on Amazon, or maybe I'm just in a different tier.
I've definitely seen $3 or $4.99. $5.99 is a little bit pricey, but I think there are some like, hey, it's only available for rental. We're not even letting you purchase it kind of situations where it's been $5.99.
I will say this much, that from a branding perspective, I suspect that the answer to your question is you don't want to be a commodity. Like, there's a reason on our little magic store, scamstuff.com, that we do our best to not compete with anybody on just commodities. Wait, what's up?
Shazam Fury of the Gods is available to rent for $19.99.
What?
Yeah, the recent movies are still pretty expensive to buy, okay, right? Yeah.
I withdraw everything I just said.
Creed 3, sounds like it's a real to rent thing. For $19.99. Wow. Okay. I don't rent movies.
New answer. The answer is Netflix doesn't want to compete on price. What they want to do is compete on exclusivity, and so that would be why they're not offering that. Now, somebody else can come along and do that.
I have a couple of other things. They don't have deals with the studios for the DVD business. So that the premise here is unfortunately mistaken. There are laws that allow them to rent DVDs out. There are deals in the sense of paying for rentable DVD copies, but it's not the same as a deal to stream something. Essentially, they can't do this. If they get a deal to be able to stream a movie, they stream it on Netflix at the price that Netflix has. There's not a separate deal to be had because they have the DVD of it. Those are just two separate things. And so the reason that the rentals are $5.99 for the older stuff is because that makes the most money. And if it were a streaming deal that Netflix could then allow you to stream it, it's the kind of price that they have to pay for it that it just makes sense to bundle it into regular Netflix. So there just isn't a business there, to put it bluntly.
So if I'm hearing you correctly, people should write into cordkillers@gmail.com with their questions.
Well, I would put it a little differently, Brian. I would say if you have a question, write into cordkillers@gmail.com.
Bryce, you want to meet in the middle here?
Yeah, if you've got
a query?
If you've got a thought, why don't you put it in a little digital bottle, sail it on over to us over the digital ocean highway?
Well, folks, that's going to do it for us. Our website is cordkillers.com. Once again, that email address, cordkillers@gmail.com. We're live on twitch.tv/nightattack Mondays at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, and we will kill your cords again next time. See you then.
Hey, Tom, Merritt, what's going on?
I'm just hanging out here watching this scroll go by. What are you doing?
Trying to set up a bit where we thank our beautiful, beautiful patrons, all these wonderful names.
I'm sorry,
names.
I'm too distracted looking at these beautiful, beautiful patron names going by. Look at that one. I mean, if you wanted to be one of these people, patreon.com/cordkillers would be the place to go.
I mean, they're scratching our itch, like, because we're addicted.
I think as long as it's consensual, like,
we're addicted to their money.
And love. Might as well face it.
Well, God damn it.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.